We start with the wild day for the markets. It started out looking like total chaos on Wall Street. Stocks were getting slammed right at the open. The Dow was down nearly 550 points at the lows. The Nasdaq was getting crushed. But then, just like magic,
boom.
A reversal of fortune, and everything was awesome once again. Stocks staging a major comeback, the Dow ending the day down less than 0.5%, just over 100 points. The Nasdaq and S&P snapping back as well, so is today's action a sign the market lows are in, and is it safe to put fresh money to work? Guy.
You know, last night, Dan, fresh money
to work. What do you think of that word, by the way?
I like it in certain contexts, in the context
of... Not with money?
For some reason, it just irritates me.
Should you believe the bounce is the question?
No, I don't think so. And Pete and I were talking in the green room prior to the show.
Nice chat.
And actually, independently, we came up with the same conclusion that although today felt like a bottom, and obviously the reversal was pretty interesting, and I think gave bulls renewed optimism, I don't think the worst is over for a number of different reasons that we've talked about and can continue to talk about. I think the situation with China continues to get worse. And I got to tell you something. The earnings reports that we've seen, especially today, had nothing to do with the Fed. I mean, they had everything to do with companies that see a slowdown, and that doesn't hearken well, I think, going forward.
They see a slowdown, they see the impact of tariffs, they see increased materials costs, increased labor costs, increased freight costs.
You're starting to get some data points. We had a Richmond Fed out this morning. People are like, well, Richmond Fed, what does that mean? Well, you know, you're seeing continuation of these regional Fed surveys that show, first of all, the job market, there's not enough skilled workers. That means a lot of companies are actually foregoing projects. You're seeing major price input pressure, and you're seeing actually more weakness in terms of confidence. So some of it's not time for Sarah and Tegan, Dan, and I know you listen to them at home.
The but everything is awesome.
Everything is not awesome. And in fact, I would look at high yield as a place to say everything's not awesome. In fact, we're getting near two-year lows on high yield. And people want to say, hey, it's not affecting credit. Guess what? It will affect credit. And I do think that when you consider that money's been almost free and the Fed is guiding to a very different paradigm in the near term, I actually think there's reason to continue to stay cautious. But there's zero reason, as Guy said, to expect that the concerns are hanging over this market.
Was this a head fake in your view?
This return back up?
Oh, yeah, the reversal.
Is everything awesome, Pete?
Well, I would say this. If you're just looking at earnings themselves, I thought they were pretty fantastic. 3M aside, you look at the rest of them.
Caterpillar wasn't bad. They just
the numbers
raise.
Were great, but their guidance was a little bit off. And why was that? Probably because of the Chinese tariffs, right? I mean, that's one of the big things I think that's affecting a lot of this right now. But I think it's really interesting. We saw a lot of VXX buying, and what that means is people in the short term feel like the volatility is here to stay. So we'll see how long of a stay it is. We had that spike up today. We didn't get up and through 25. Dan, I know you're. The guy was talking about optimism, and I know that that was going against what you've been right. We've seen this market going down, 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 some choppy down to the downside. I would say this. I would say earnings are great, but a lot of this guidance has been something concerning, and it's because we don't have clarity. And when you don't have clarity, people get confused, and they don't know exactly how they want to react.
So, you know, as far as the rally off the bottom, I mean, if all the indices had closed green on the day, I would have said you're going to have a couple-day rally into, let's say, Thursday's earnings, which are going to be really important, obviously, as we get into MAGA. The only way out of this is MAGA.
It's
the only way out of
it. I'm telling you.
It's the only way out of this correction right now. Otherwise,
can
it is a bear market
MAGA
rally right now. Oh, it's the Microsoft, the Apple. The
Where's
Amazon,
your hat?
The Google.
Where's your hat?
Listen.
Seriously, could you put a hat on?
But I'm being very serious.
We're gonna get
it's
out.
The
we'll
only
get
way out of this. And you said, Kat, I heard the commentators this morning say it was great.
Yeah, it was.
Dude, that stock was $160 2 weeks ago. Yesterday on the close, it was $131. This morning when I turned on Squawk in front, or Squawk Box, it was trading at $118 or something like that. There was nothing good about it.
There actually was. There was a lot good about it.
Oh, really?
The problem was
down on the day.
The vision going forward was the problem.
They said markets were healthy. They said pricing remains good.
Let's
cost
see, so
discipline
far,
helped.
One, so
they
Mel,
beat on
okay.
the quarter,
so Mel,
but
what
they
I'm
didn't
saying,
raise
sentiment
their
was
guidance.
Already horrible
trading
going into the print.
Times.
You would have thought they could have said anything and met their numbers and the stock would have
but
gone up.
But maybe it's what they didn't say that speaks volumes. Maybe it's the fact they didn't raise guidance for the first time
since
the beginning of 2016. Right, exactly.
Why would they?
Exactly.
They're
Why
doing
would
the right
they?
Thing.
Which raises the whole notion that there are clouds in the horizon that perhaps we just don't know about. They're taking the conservative route.
Well, yeah, I think if you know, Caterpillar, I think we got this last quarter, too, out of these guys. I don't think that there's any reason if you're a big industrial play that is certainly a global play. And again, John Deere is positioned differently. They are much more positioned domestically on the industrial side. Caterpillar is a global company. And in fact, they need to see orders out of China. And in fact, that's where, you know, I think the trade war will start to kick in. And remember, I'll repeat, I don't think that we've gotten on the macro side in terms of economic data outside of some of these regional Fed surveys anything that indicates we're in a trade war right now on this soil. The companies are the ones that need to tell you that. And when they guide weaker or at least tell you that they're not as ambitious as they were last quarter,
I don't think it's about ambition. I think it's the fact that they don't have the clarity because we haven't made any decisions going forward.
But that
alone tells you something.
Yes. In the face of a Fed that seems so sure.
A Fed that's so sure.
And so right. on its path to raise rates.
And very transparent.
That they're
headstrong.
Exactly.
Headstrong, but also transparent. So we have a sense of what the Fed thinks and what they're likely to do, right? I think we have a very strong sense of how they're going to be reacting and how they're going to be going forward. But what we don't know is, does the president ever get something done with this negotiations with China? That's what we don't know. And that's why Kat can't give you great guidance because they don't know.
This could be a great setup for the people who are really conditioned to buy the dip. As we head into, we're likely to see more volatility into the midterms. Let's say there's a result that the markets like. Let's say we continue to be volatile. There's a good chance that volatility settles down. There's a good chance we move a little higher. Let's say those MAGA results are pretty good. And then let's say there is some resolution or there's light at the end of the tunnel to the trade thing, you have the S&P back up at 2,900 like that into year end. I mean, that is probably the best case scenario over the next 2 months.
Do you think that's going to happen?
Well, I think there's a scenario where the midterms don't really, they don't cause volatility post-election. And I think there's a scenario where if it goes the way of the current administration, where they have now the ability to kind of do what they need to do on the trade front.
I'll just get back to you. Germany was down 2.3% today and is now near December 2016 lows. The rest of the world is really suffering. I think this is telling us more than we want.
And at what point should we be concerned about how the rest of the world is doing in relationship to the U.S.? Does something have to give?
Until the last couple weeks, nothing's had to give, right? We've said, the U.S. is its own thing.
But now,
obviously, things are starting to even out. And we've brought up Deutsche Bank 100 times on this show, and European banks have been a drain. Now, the question is, why is Citibank trading where it's? I think Citibank make a 52-week low today?
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a reason why Citibank made a 52-week low. I think it's because of their exposure to Europe. Everybody says that Deutsche Bank is contained, it's not systemic. I have no idea, clearly. But I can't say categorically that it's not systemic the way I can't say categorically that it's contained. Something clearly is going on with
European
banks.
So everything is not awesome.
I hate that.
Pretty much across the board, that's what the agreement is on the desk.